Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent guest and episode for you, but before I go ahead, let me remind you to subscribe to the channel and also check out all the previous content there. Also, let me acknowledge our partners, the Digital Health platform Clinitouch V, and our industry partner Isaac Care. But today gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Tom Lawry. He's the National Director for Artificial Intelligence, Health and Life Sciences at Microsoft. He's also a best-selling author and a speaker. Tom, how are you?
I'm doing great today. Thanks for having me on.
No, brilliant. Nice to connect with you. I've been following your work for a while. We've been connected, so I'm delighted to have you here.
Me too.
And today we are here to discuss AI, artificial intelligence in health and medicine. And the first question that I have for you, Tom, is tell us about your new book, Hacking Healthcare, and how AI and the intelligence revolution will reboot and ailing the system.
Well, great question. My new book, Hacking Healthcare, just released worldwide last week. So great opportunity to be talking with you about it. So Hacking Healthcare, really, it starts with the premise of looking at what did healthcare learn from fighting a global pandemic? And, you know, there are several things that I can touch on, but essentially we learned that obviously when health of a person or population is good, everything works better. When it's not, we come painfully close to the awareness of how health affects economics, family security and safety, and a whole host of other things. So in the last 2 years, we learned actually some good things. We learned that an industry that's normally known for moving at glacial speed can, in fact, move at warp speed when it needs to. We learned that clinical and health leaders are capable of agile transformation. And then to your point, a lot of the agile part of the transformation we've seen in the last 2 years to fight a global pandemic had to do with greater use of AI or artificial intelligence. And so there are a number of examples that I could cite, but essentially we saw that people fought the battle for the global pandemic. The tools they used, though, to help win and win faster were AI related. And the premise of the book goes on from there to say, if we can use AI to fight this global pandemic, let's look at how to take our learnings, including use of AI, and apply it to all those other big health and medical problems like chronic disease and the opioid crisis and helping restore physicians to being the kind of clinicians they want to be rather than many times the data entry clerks were turning them into.
Brilliant. Thank you, Tom. Certainly, AI is now has a different dimension in terms of practical applications. We're all learning around it. And thank you so much for that. The second question is, a lot has changed in the past 2.5 years because of the pandemic. You just mentioned that. What has healthcare learned from the global pandemic? What is the main thing, do you think?
Well, once again, I think, it's an industry traditionally steeped in going slow. There are certain things like clinical protocols that, you know, we've all been trained on, but sometimes we go slow on things that we don't need to, or we're more resistant to change than we should be. And so perhaps a really good example would be looking at what's happened in the last 2 years to your question of in telehealth. Clinically, the research shows telehealth has been around for 3 decades. It's been shown to be very efficient, very efficacious in doing a lot of the same things that traditionally, you know, we force people to get in their car or take the subway, go to a doctor's office, sit in a little cubicle, and that same thing was done online. And the question is, why did it take a pandemic to pull forward things like telehealth? And, you know, the answer is, an old mentor of mine used to say, when you feel the heat, you see the light. And so all of a sudden telehealth and telemedicine came into existence in ways previously not seen. Consumers got to try it. The majority from all the studies I'm seeing indicated that for a lot of things, they actually would prefer to be doing telehealth. And the same with some of the clinicians. So we look at that. We look at use of artificial intelligence to do other things such as personalizing care in ways that previously we were touching on, but the pandemic forced everyone to reevaluate how they did work and how they practice medicine.
Brilliant, Tom. Thank you so much. I really like that. When you, let me see if I get it right. When you feel the heat, you see the
light. When you feel the heat, you see the light.
Yeah, I really like that. So
well, good. I'm glad I gave you something to think about.
No, it's brilliant. I mean, also, I mean, in other linking to the analogy, in other words, we'd be forced to feel the heat and act in a different way. That's so, I like that what you mentioned about telehealth. Actually, it's been around for quite some time, but now we push to use it and to really apply in practical terms. Thank you so much. Moving on to the third question. There is a lot of talk and frankly hype about the use of artificial intelligence in health and medicine. And what are you seeing in use of AI? And how is it being used to drive real change?
Yeah. No, great question. And again, to your point, you know, for a number of years, AI has been what I call the shiny object of healthcare. You go to a conference, everyone's talking about it. If you go through an exhibit hall in any conference that relates to health and medicine, pretty much everyone's saying they do artificial intelligence. Whether in fact they are or not is another discussion. So what's really important is to squeeze out the hype and really start looking at how and where we're using artificial intelligence to do real things that improve the quality of care, that improve the effectiveness of care. And so there are a lot of stories to be told. I tell a number of them in the book as far as some of the latest stories. But, you know, I can cite examples, but probably the most important thing for anyone to consider is this. For all the hype about AI, the only thing you need to know about healthcare and AI is this. AI only adds value if it does one of two things. It automates the way humans do work, or it augments the way humans do work. So that's how it drives value. So automation means things done by humans now will be done by machines going forward. A lot of that is that low value repetitive activity sort of thing that is required in certain jobs. But the biggest use of artificial intelligence is really in healthcare and health and medicine is going to come by augmenting what people do. I mean, think about this. The majority of anyone who works in healthcare is a knowledge worker. And so the idea is AI is not going to replace them. Instead, it's going to come in behind them to help them do something they care about better. And it does that by a number of things, including most often reducing, again, those lower value repetitive activities that we force knowledge workers through each and every day. So as we squeeze out those lower value things, it frees up clinicians to do other things like spend more time actually with patients, looking them in the eye instead of hunting and pecking in the cubicle with their EMR. It does things like allow them to have more time to do research or God forbid, actually get home more often on time for dinner. So the way AI is driving value in anything, it's either going to automate the way work is done, or it's going to augment the work of knowledge workers to make them better at what they care about.
Brilliant. Tom, thank you so much. Yeah, I mean, it's really important. It's really an important conversation also to clarify, simplify, and remove that unnecessary hype, if you like. And you mentioned that in a really nice way. Moving on to the fourth and last question is, what are the challenges that you seeing as we look ahead to where healthcare is going in the next few years?
Well, I think the biggest challenge is, I believe, and again, I talk about it in the book, we have what I call the coming care calamity, where You look at all the needs we have, things as simple as look at the growth of those who are turning 65, their healthcare needs going forward. We clearly will reach a point with all of the health needs and the way we practice health and medicine today, there'll be far more needs than there are trained clinicians and workers to be able to support the needs of all the people we're trying to serve. So that's where back to automate and augment AI comes in. The greater use of artificial intelligence is going to help resolve things like some of the dramatic clinician shortages we already have that will only get worse. They will better prepare us for whatever that next big global health crisis is going to look like. And a lot of that boils down to this. It's a little bit about technology. It's a little bit about data science and how to develop algorithms. But value comes when AI is used to change those clinical workflows, to change the way in which we have work processes occurring. There are all the things we used to do that can be made better as far as changing the process. Changing process is a human thing. It relates to expertise. It relates to what I call AI leadership, of leaders looking at, just as they did with the global pandemic, what wasn't working, and how to change and adapt using technology to not only keep services going, but actually make them better. That is the challenge. And to me, that is the opportunity going forward.
Brilliant. Thank you, Tom. We come to the end of the interview. Thank you, Tom, for accepting the invite, but also for these magnificent insights.
Well, it's my pleasure. I'm so glad that you invited me on today.
I'm not sure if you've seen my previous recordings, but I finish all my interviews in a peculiar way. It's not a question as such. I think it's very appropriate for you right now. It's called 1 minute of fame, and you can talk about anything, your work, personal life, achievements, maybe any new books. So over to you, Tom, to round up 1 minute.
Well, I guess I'd quickly say thank you for that pop surprise. No, I think just what we've been talking about, we're living in very interesting times. I believe this book, Hacking Healthcare, my earlier book, AI and Health, it really is all about, how do we harness the power of our data, of artificial intelligence to do good? And the dedication of Hacking Healthcare simply states, health and medicine is a very noble profession, and the book is dedicated to all of those who are trying to make it better. So I've spent my entire life career in and around healthcare. It is a very noble cause. It's also one of the most challenging areas that needs our help. And so our ability to bring all of this together and have a collective of what we do to support those on the front lines is really, to me, what gets me very excited every day. And at Microsoft, we focus very heavily on how we're using technology to get behind and support all of those who are on the front lines of health and medicine every day.
Brilliant. Tom, what a great way to finish. Thank you so much again for being in here. I'm delighted to have this conversation with you and to share with all our industry,
It's been my pleasure. Thanks so much.
Thank you. I'm going to round up now to all our viewers and listeners. Make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also, let me acknowledge our partners, the digital health platform CliniTouch V, and our industry partner, Isaac Care. And also, I'm going to post Tom's link to his new book, his social profiles, including his LinkedIn. Come back to him, ask him questions about the industry, about healthcare, and I'll see you all next week.